Brendan, we're here at the Consumer Products Conference, Barclays Conference, obviously. A lot of the biggest consumer products companies are here, big food, big beverage, some of them already partners with you. What's the mood in terms of how they view the cannabis space?
I think there's a lot of interest. I think that if you look, there aren't a whole lot of global growth opportunities. And so lots of Fortune 500 CPG brands are looking at the cannabis industry as an area for potential growth over the next decade.
And how do they get into it? Because that's always a sort of hot question for them, just like it is with the sort of plant-based proteins.
They're very cautious, obviously. And when we were in the process of having conversations with the Sandoz division of Novartis or Anheuser-Busch InBev ABI, those conversations sort of, they're exploratory at first, and in the past they've taken up to a year from that sort of first contact to getting to a point where we could sign an agreement.
And there's some reason for that caution, because we have seen this sector, you know, really sort of eviscerated recently in terms of share price movement. We've seen, obviously, your own company, Tilray, but also a lot of competitors get downgraded and the value decrease a lot. Is that just a function of the fact that this market got so overheated at the beginning and now people are realizing potentially it's going to be big, but not as big?
I think it's going to be as big. I just think that we're in such an early stage, right? If you think about medical cannabis, 41 countries in the world out of 196 to 20% penetration, I expect we'll see that double over the next 2 years to 80 countries. And in terms of adult use, all of this volatility, all of this attention is around two countries, right? Uruguay and Canada, not two of the largest countries in the world, 1% of the world's countries that have legalized adult use. And I think it's going to take, I think we'll see four more countries over the next, let's call it 18 months. But you'll see this continual addition of countries that legalize adult use in this sort of steady progress, ultimately leading to, I think, $150 to $200 billion industry transitioning from prohibition to legalization.
I want to come back to the users, but just for a second, let's play that scenario out. We do see this huge growth in the industry. Are you, and I suppose some of your peers, actually positioned to meet that demand? Because it is, as you say, it's such a young industry. Is the actual production there to see that when it does come on stream?
We started 2018 with 60,000 square feet of manufacturing space. We started this year, 2019, with 1.1 million square feet. Today we have 3.4 million square feet. So we're adding capacity. We've, you know, added 200% capacity just between the start of this year and today. We've started to grow cannabis outdoors with THC in Portugal. So we have 60 acres growing there. So we'll continually add capacity throughout the coming years. At the same time, we're buying supply from farmers, so cannabis raw materials from farmers around the world with the intent of importing that into Portugal so that we can manufacture finished goods.
And I think in the last quarter, you exported about 6 tons, which was up considerably, about 80% year on year. The price came down. Is there anything you can do to control the price of the product you're selling, or is that just set by the market?
It's really product mix is what affected our average selling price per gram. So we sold a little bit more wholesale to both flower and oil to some of our competitors in Canada. We also exported a little bit less oil last quarter than we have previously. In Q4, when we see the new products being allowed in Canada, I would expect the average selling price per gram to increase with those value-add products.
And in terms of the users, I get, you know, it's still a relatively new product in any country it's in, certainly legally. There is a novelty factor there, so you do get a lot of people trying it for the first time. You also have this big market, which is, I suppose, people moving out of iniquity and into the legalized market. How sticky are the new users? Are these people just trying it once, or is this sort of more repeat business?
In every country outside of North America, our products are sold in pharmacies, right? So we have a pharmaceutical sales force that goes out and educates physicians and pharmacists and some patient advocacy groups so that they understand this product. It doesn't work for everyone, but the patients that it works for are consistent purchasers at pharmacies.